Good morning. We welcome you this morning in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. I hope that all of you had electricity last night. We've got one or two individuals that I've talked to so far that didn't, but we're glad that you are here. We will talk just a little bit more about what's taking place in the life of the church later on. This is a day to celebrate and to worship. Let's stand together as we enter into worship this morning. But before we do that, let's thank the Lord for calling us into His presence. Amen. Master, we rejoice with you. We are so grateful for all that you do for us. We gather today intentionally to worship you and to celebrate with you. You are so good to us. Thank you, Lord, for loving us the way you do. In Jesus' name, amen.
Yeah. And just greet those around you.
Thank you. Praise the Lord. It's good to have you here today and to worship together the Lord Jesus Christ. A couple things I'd like to make known real quick. After the service is over and before you go to Sunday school or leave to go home, there is a celebration cake in the gathering place today. We burnt our mortgage in the middle of December, and today we're eating cake. So you can have your cake and
eat it.
There you go. All right, so enjoy yourself right after church, okay? Also, we'd like to make known that this Wednesday night, we will begin some marriage enrichment classes in the gathering place. We concluded a great weekend. Snow or not, we had about 20 couples show up for our marriage enrichment weekend. It was a great time with the Rowells, and we're going to kick off this Wednesday night at 6:45 in the gathering place for about a six-week study on different kinds of things that will help our marriages. So it's a video series, and we invite you to come 6:45 on Wednesday night for about the next 6 weeks. Also, we are going to be having a home fellowship group celebration evening on the first Sunday night of February. We are looking for some host homes. And in your bulletin today, on the tear-off piece, there's a little place that says up at the top of it, if you are interested in opening your home up for a fellowship group to come, because we'll begin signing up next week, if you just tear that off, put your name on it, and drop it at the Welcome Center out in the lobby, and we'll begin to get people coming to your house on the first Sunday night of February. That's Super Bowl Sunday, and I'm feeling like it could happen. So, all right. At least there's one more week at the very least, and it was a good weekend. Okay, very good. Ushers, if you'd come, I'd like to receive our tithe and offering this morning. Shall we give thanks? Our precious Lord Jesus, we are so thankful for the way in which you allow us to partner with you in ministry around this community and world. So, Lord Jesus, as we bring and place our tithe in your hands and any offerings that you speak to our heart about bringing in addition, we pray, Lord, that you would multiply the impact in the people of the world that we get a chance to tell the good news to. So bless, Lord Jesus, this tithe and these offerings in your name. Amen.
Looking out from his throne, the Father of light and of men, chose to make himself known and show us the way back to him. Speaking wisdom and truth into the hearts of peasants and kings, he began to unveil the word that would change the course of all things. With eyes wide open, all would see the word is alive, and it cuts like a sword through the darkness, with a message of life to the hopeless and afraid, breathing life into all who believe. The word is alive, and the world and its glory will fade, but its truth, it will not pass away. It remains yesterday and forever the same. The word is alive. Simple strokes on a page, eternity's secrets revealed, carried on from age to age, It speaks truth to us even still. As the rain falls from heaven, feeds the earth before it returns. Lord, let your word fall on us and bring forth the fruit you deserve. With eyes wide open, let us see. The word is alive, and it cuts like a sword through the darkness, with a message of life to the hopeless and afraid, breathing life into all who believe. The word is alive, and the world and its glories will fade, but its truth, it will not pass away. It remains yesterday and forever the same. The word is alive. The Bible was inscribed over a period of 2,000 years in times of war and days of peace by kings, physicians, tax collectors, farmers, fishermen, singers, and shepherds. The marvel is that a library so perfectly cohesive could have been produced by such a diverse crowd over a period of time staggers the imagination. Jesus is the grand subject, and the glory of God is its end. The word is alive, and it cuts like a sword through darkness, with the message of life to the hopeless and the afraid, breathing life into all who believe. The word is alive, and the world and its glories will fade, but its truth, it will not pass away. It remains yesterday and forever the same. The word is alive. The word is alive. The word is alive.
Can say amen. Amen. We've broken open the bread of life and read it, and it has transformed our heart, our thinking, our minds. The word of God is living and active, and it is God breathed. It is powerful, and I encourage us to just dive in and eat every day from this bread of life. Amen. This song that we're going to sing is, it's very fitting. It's written, inspired by Psalm 46, Lord of Hosts.
Come, behold the works of God, the nations at his feet. He breaks the bow and bends the spear and tells the wars to cease. O mighty one of Israel, you are on our side. see the nations rage. I know my God is in control. Though the oceans roar, you are the Lord of all, the one who calms the wind and waves and makes my heart be still. Though the earth gives way, the mountains move into the sea, the nations rage, I know my God is in control. Lord of hosts, you're with us in the fire, with us as a shelter, with us in the storm. You will lead us through the fiercest battle. Oh, where else would we go with the Lord of hosts? You are with us, with us as a shelter, with us in the storm. You will lead us through the fiercest battle. Oh, where else would we go with the Lord of hosts?
You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies. Till all my fears are gone, and I'm no longer a slave. And I'm no longer a slave to fear.
We'd like to open our altars for any that would like to come and kneel down and pray this morning. Make your way forward if you'd like to at this time. I'm reminded of an acronym for fear. Future events appear real. And every now and then we get caught up thinking about the things that might happen. And it immobilizes us. How good it is to know that he has us in his hands. And that I don't have to be a slave to that anymore, because Jesus is on my side.
Lord, we're grateful for the opportunity to be in your presence, to lift our voice of praise and adoration to you. We're so grateful for who you are, the way that you minister to us, journey with us. You are our constant companion. We thank you, Lord, and we praise you. We ask, Father, that you would help us today. It is our desire to draw closer to you, to learn more about how to be servants of the one true God. And I pray, Father, that you would speak to the very center of our heart today. Help us, Lord, to hear the message that you have for us. Lord, we have mixed emotions as we think of Pauline today. We miss her, but we're excited for her. And I pray, Father, that you would be with her family today. We know that they also have mixed emotions. I pray, Lord, for those kneeling at an altar of prayer today. And I pray, Father, that what needs they lift up, concerns they may have, I pray that they would be received by a loving and compassionate God, and that you would respond to them. Speak also, Lord, to those here in the sanctuary, those that are praying where they stand. And I ask, Father, that you will help them and encourage them in their journey. Be with Pastor Dave as he brings forth your word to us. I know that you have been speaking to him about this, and I pray, Father, your holy unction upon him as he brings forth your message to us. Thank you, Father, for the message we are about to receive in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated.
Amen. Well, the sermon this morning is entitled, Let's Be Different, Let's Be Christian. Intentionally meant to challenge us to think about the difference that should be evident in our lives because we are living for Jesus. It should be obvious. So as we think about this message today, we're going to be looking at Matthew chapter 6, verses 25 to 34, a very familiar passage of Scripture about choosing not to worry and to trust God, and choosing also to make a commitment to seek first his kingdom, and then everything else I trust that the Lord will speak from a very familiar passage of Scripture to us this morning. The goal of a disciple, which is our focus this entire 2019 year, being confident of this, that he who began a good work in us will be faithful to complete it. So the goal of being a disciple is trusting God to work on this project called our lives. And I trust that we can have this great awareness of how it looks to be more like Jesus each day than the day before. The reality is, as Charles Colson put in a book several years ago, Faith on the Line, Colson says, quote, "America is a nation in transition. Powerful forces are shaking our very substance. It seems that we have been irreversibly changed, but I don't believe that to be true. While it is true that powerful forces had been at work to change our culture, our way of living, those forces are no match for Jesus Christ," end quote. So what is the answer, Christian? Is it not Jesus living in us and making us? So let's look at what Jesus says in the Sermon on the Mount, chapter 6 of Matthew, verses 25 to 34. Listen to Jesus as he speaks to those gathered on the hillside. "Therefore I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothes? Look at the birds of the air. They neither sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they?" Question: can any one of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your life? That is a very unfair question, Jesus. We just worry so easily, and by nature, it just kind of seems to periodically creep up in our lives. But Jesus says, can any one of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your life? "And why do you worry about clothes? See how the flowers of the field grow? They don't labor or spin. Yet I tell you that not even Solomon in all of his splendor was dressed like one of these. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and tomorrow thrown into the fire, will he not much more clothe you, you of little faith? So do not worry, saying, 'What shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear?' For the pagans run after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own." I kind of wish he'd end it a little differently, don't you? Than just each day is going to be full of trouble. It's going to have its own set of circumstances. But we begin our journey with Christ in a response to his words, men and women. When Jesus said to the disciples and was picking his team to work with him, it's the same thing he says to you and I. "Come, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men." There are a couple vital discipleship truths in these words of Jesus that we looked at. We are to follow Jesus. Chuck Colson said also, quote, "We are a people wandering in a spiritual wilderness, searching frantically for our roots and seeking understanding from the context in which we live," end quote. That's a description of those not following Jesus, as we're trying to make sense of how our life is playing out, and we're trying to make it all fit together, searching as if somehow you and I have the ability to make sense of our life. How many of you know today you have no control over what's about to happen? We like to think we have control, and we put into place all the things that we think can govern things that happen, but then all of a sudden, out of the midst of nowhere comes things that we have no control over whatsoever. And yet we find ourselves, like Colson said, wandering, frantically looking for understanding in the context in which we live. But that is not what Jesus teaches us. In fact, I'd go so far as to say our aimless wandering and searching for truth and the meaning of life ended when we started following Jesus. Did it not? Didn't Jesus answer some questions for you that you had never had answered before? The context for the way we live is grounded in living the way Jesus lives us. Or leads us to live. So the first thing is following Jesus is imperative to how he works in our life. The second thing is Jesus' job to make us. For the first time, it isn't about what we are making of ourselves or what anyone else is trying to make us into. It's about Jesus making us into something. Quite frankly, I would have settled for far too low of a goal. If I would have become what I wanted to become, more people would have known who I was, but I would not have been what Jesus had intended for me to be. And if I would have allowed some well-intentioned people who said things to me like, I think you should be, well-intentioned, but they're not really in charge of making us into something. It is not until we begin following the will of Jesus Christ when he says, come follow me, that we begin to see coming into play the idea that he is making us into what he has in mind. And I can honestly say that I am thankful Jesus Christ got my attention. Because I have ADD, and I wasn't sure he knew that. And my attention easily goes a lot of different places, but he grabbed a hold of my attention and corralled me, so to speak. Listen again. I know I'm quoting Chuck Colson a lot today, but I love this book of his. When he talks about deeper issues, listen to what he says. Quote, if you follow the daily headlines, you will quickly conclude that the dominant issues in American society are economic policy or budget deficits or social security in every sense of the term or conflicts between conservative and liberal political philosophies. But these are the surface issues of humanity. The deeper issues are first, what values will we live by? By the truth of God, the holy word of God, or the arbitrary relative whims of the humanist elite? And second, who will set the moral agenda, the church or the bureaucratic social planners and the vested economic interests of a secular pagan society? America's moral leadership is up for grabs. End quote. I think he's dead on. Now, what I didn't say to you is he wrote this book 30 years ago. Now, just multiply that by a lot of time. And yet we see the same things playing out again and again and again. The outcome of today's revolution will be determined by how we respond to the cries of our people for moral direction and for vision. Again, I ask you, did you hear what Chuck Colson said? America's moral leadership is up for grabs. We really can't afford to wait any longer to grab a hold of the morality of God and be distinctively different. I think truly the world needs to see a distinctively different group of people living for Jesus. I mean, radically, distinctively different. We can't afford to get our marching orders for the way we live by a culture that neither acknowledges the morality instituted by God or one that chooses to interpret God's directives from their own subjective viewpoint. You do understand, don't you, that there is an ability to make the Word of God say anything you want it to say. Just pull it out of context, have it be a preface for something that you want to teach, and you can make it say anything you want. But that's not the way that it's intended to be studied. So within the context of the Word of God and the structure of the Word of God, let the Holy Spirit begin to illuminate your heart to the absolute truth of God, which will establish you and make you ready to be distinctively different as a follower of God. And with that intent, Jesus has the ability to speak loudly and clearly to a world of people, I believe, who are still searching for the meaning of life. You know that that's the impetus of so many people's lives. What does life mean? What is truth? And people are searching and people are trying their best to make sense out of it. Do you believe that the power of the Holy Spirit in this 2019 year still has the ability to open the eyes of men and women and bring them to a place where they, for the first time in their lives, understand what it means to be Christian? I do. If I didn't, I honestly would give you my resignation right now. Because if I didn't believe that, you would want somebody else up here who did believe that Jesus Christ makes a difference in this culture that we live in today. And that he desires to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ to the neighbors and the family and the friends that we have in our lives who are searching for the answer. See, part of the problem from my perspective is that we became aware of the answer a long time ago, and we just don't talk about it like we used to. That's my opinion. That somehow, some way, we have found ourselves now engaged in conversations that are not quite the same as they were when Jesus Christ got a hold of our lives and changed us from sin dead in sin to alive in him. And I think people really want to see the radical difference that Jesus Christ can make in our lives. In my opinion, our marching orders now that we have started following Jesus is to seek first the kingdom of God and then trust that all the needed details will be taken care of. He'll make sure that you eat and drink and have clothes. The necessities, God's got it. Commercials on TV, lawyers tell us, Mike's got it. You've had a problem? Trust me, I've got it. Or I like this one. We don't get paid till we get you money. I mean, the promises. I've got it. Do we believe Jesus has got it? Does he got me? That was terrible English. But I wanted to say it that way, intentionally. Oh, Jesus, grab a hold of us. Make us. The necessities, God's got it. Just don't get caught up in making that the focus. He has so much more than just the necessities we need. The secular culture is all about running after things because things are pursued to elevate meaning and satisfaction. The truth is, quickly, things lose their allure. And we want new things. Have any of you ever said anything like, if I ever get this, I'll never want anything ever again? Anybody ever said that? If this could just happen, I would never want anything again until the next thing I want. The truth is, quickly things lose their allure. The solution is seek God's kingdom and righteousness, and that's what brings satisfaction and meaning to a disciple's life. One last time, Colson says about eternal citizenship. He says, quote, first, we must recognize that our eternal citizenship is in the kingdom of God, as clearly stated by Paul in Philippians. We are but wanderers in this nation. Beloved though it is, we are clearly commanded by our Lord to seek first the kingdom of God. I am thankful for the way God takes care of me. How about you? I don't mean, are you thankful the way he takes care of me? I mean, are you thankful for the way he takes care of you? Isn't it awesome how God takes care of us? And yet I tell you that as we journey, we're aliens on this earth. This is not it. He's wonderful to take care of our necessities and our needs right here and right now. Praise be to God. But this is not it. It is eternal. Forever citizenship in the kingdom of God. We are clearly commanded by our Lord to seek first the kingdom of God. Seek first the kingdom of God. Now the kingdom of God begins to unfold in us the moment Jesus Christ enters into our life. He brings and ushers into us the kingdom of God. When he said, come follow me, and we begin the journey, he enters into us. But this is not it. This is just the beginning. And he's taking us to it. Many people are frustrated by the apostasy and the declining morality in America today. It's evident on all sides. It's no wonder that Christians today yearn for the good old days of moral absolutes, when young people prayed in schools and parents retained authority over their children and folks loved their country and respected one another and their property, and life was so much simpler then. Indeed, the decay of American culture demands our involvement. There must be a Christian influence in every facet of society. Christians need to participate and vote. Christians need to work from within and without to see that the government is an instrument of social justice. Sure, that's true. And Colson says, the longer I'm a Christian, the more I realize that the vague deity of American civil religion is a heretical rejection of Christ of the Holy Scripture. So, don't confuse your loyalties. Never assume the will of the majority and the will of God are synonymous. Wow. That is so blatantly true. That oftentimes the will of the majority that ushers into our fabric of society brings into be immoral behaviors. And that is not synonymous with the will of God. Huh. They may be radically different and frequently are. So Christian men and women, Let's be different. Let's not be consumed with worry about the material things and the necessities. Let's have faith that God will provide. And I would just throw this caveat out if you want. Worry if you want. But all that energy you expend in the process won't add anything to your life. And do you know whether you're worrying about something that ends up happening or something that doesn't happen at all, you still burn the energy? Worry if you want, or you could choose to seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. For it is the righteousness of God in us that defines us as the disciples of Christ. So come, follow me, Jesus says, and I will make you, because we are confident that God who started in us is faithful to complete the work. Now, I want us to stand together and sing this beautiful, beautiful song called Above All. Above everything on this planet, Lord Jesus, I will seek first your kingdom and your righteousness, and I will trust you with taking care of me here and now and leading me to it. Jesus Christ paid the price that we might be saved. Imagine the intention and purpose of God was to save you. And he did what only he could do. So let's let the salvation of Jesus Christ shine out in us to a world who could experience the same thing. Heavenly Father, we thank you this morning for your goodness to us and your presence in our life. Thank you, Jesus, for meeting with our hearts today and reminding us what it means to be your child. Thank you for starting in us this great work of redemption and bring it to fruition, Lord, we pray. Thank you for all that you have done. Lord, our prayers are for the lost and broken people of our world. We bask in the glory of God this morning. We recognize your redeeming love and your presence. But so many people do not know you today, Jesus, and it breaks our heart. So please, Lord Jesus, take us into our world and let us shine the light in the darkness so that you might dispel the darkness of many, many people's souls. Thank you, Jesus, for your goodness to us and being with us this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Remain standing as Pastor Joe pronounces our benediction today.
May you cherish the enormous attention given to you by the one true God. And may you have confidence that the God of all ages will continue to love you each step of your journey, becoming more like him. Go in peace.